Knights. Hello, knights.
What do you want, Reala?
Hello, knights.
Yes, hello. What do you want?
Knights.
What the bloody hell do you want, Reala?
I wanna smash.
For every protagonist, there has to be an opposing character to rival them, someone to give them a difficult time and make us as an audience root for our hero even more. Or if you like your coffee a little on the darker side, then you know, support the bad guys, innit? Whatever dunks your donuts. Once upon a time, when Sonic Team wasn't making back-to-back Sonic games, there was a brief period when creativity shone brightly, and the eagerness to build new exciting IPs was at an all-time high. Nights and Dreams, a Sega Saturn classic that earned a favourable cult status, was one such IP. With our main hero Knight nonchalantly flying her purple ass through Dreamland, there was always going to be another character just waiting to piss on her pretty parade, and that piss taker would be this Borough Harlequin mime jester Reala. Now, as I've mentioned in the past, my connection to the Knight series and its fanbase has been a fairly significant one, and from observing the community in its entirety did I sort of notice something. Whether it be the hardcore gamers chasing down the highest link scores, or the lowest of the low tier fanfiction writers slashing it up with hot steamy Knights and Reala Yaoi, for some reason, mostly everybody seemed to have this grand appreciation for Reala. And I'd like to know why. Hey, have you ever said something really awkward in a crowded room before, and just as you said it, the room just happened to suddenly go quiet, so everybody accidentally hears you, and they all turn to look at you like you're some kind of fucking weirdo? I'm feeling that right about now. Now, before you start putting words in my mouth, hear me out and let me explain myself in context, alright? When I was first introduced to Nights into Dreams as a kid, I thought Reala was pretty cool. Actually, he was one of my favourite characters from the whole game, if I'm being honest. Then, as I grew up and joined various forums, I noticed this mass admiration for Reala. You couldn't go many places within the community without seeing people utterly worship him, and for a character that literally had less than 3 minutes of screen time total, this praise seemed a little overhyped to me. The sequel, Journey of Dreams, built more upon his character, and I came away from that experience mostly conflicted. It left my perception of Reala in somewhat of a weird limbo. I didn't dislike him, no, but I couldn't feel any reason to like him as much as everybody else was. So, does that mean this is going to be a bad review then? Not at all. If anything, it's been a while since I've approached the character that I'm at odd ends with. By analysing him, I'm going to find out for myself once and for all what it is about him that made me a fan to begin with, and then what caused me to take a few steps back. Though it was probably that one hentai doujinshi where Reala had the noodle fingers!
You should probably expect spoilers.
As I said a minute ago, Reala's screen time in the first Knights game is literally a boss battle with the added inclusion of having a pre-fight cutscene. The other main level bosses in the game didn't get anything like this, so when everybody saw Reala's fight begin with some actual story development, we pretty much got lit over that shit. So what was happening in that short scene then? Well, not much if I'm being honest. Reala sits smugly in his pedestal chair before standing up and saying,
"There is no night."
Ah, the mysterious dream language. Yeah, that shit kept fans theorizing for ages. You know, the fanbase believed for over a decade that Reala was saying, "There is no night," like as a sort of diss or something. Reala will defeat night to such an extent that she will cease to exist. Yeah, we all thought Reala was just smack talking. After I interviewed Yuji Naka though, it turns out Reala's just saying, "Come on, Knights, you know, let's go, bring it on," kind of thing. Which doesn't sound half as threatening as what we thought he originally said, but it wasn't like he was gonna win anyway, was he? The two of them face off, and Knights paraloops Reala a couple of times before ultimately murking the rude boy. That was honestly the absolute maximum interaction we got between Knights and Reala in that first game. Yeah, that was it. There was nothing else to go on. And don't you even dare bring up that brief Archie comic run as somehow being canon, or so help me god, I'm gonna paraloop your balls off. Anything else we wanted to know about Reala we had to find from external sources, which let me tell you, trying to even get online in the late 90s, let alone navigate your way to a Japanese website and even understand what the bloody hell it was on about, was a nightmaric mission in itself. Eventually, through many forum discussions, research highlighted the fact that Reala does hold some relevant importance to the game. He, along with Knights, was created by Wise Man the Wicked to be his second in command. Wise Man crafted them from similar designs, making sure they both excelled at their skills of flight and combat. NiGHTS, however, was attracted to freedom. Her free will made it so she could choose to do what she wanted, and thus she chose to disobey Wiseman and live her life as she saw fit. Reala, on the other hand, chose to obey and remained as Wiseman's loyal servant, forever ready to do what his master ordered. With NiGHTS being against Wiseman's plans to invade the dreamland of Nightopia, it placed Reala and NiGHTS on opposing sides, and thus their rivalry was officially born, which eventually led to Reala getting his ass kicked. NiGHTS' Journey of Dreams attempted to tell a similar story, just with the use of many more cutscenes, and this time in favour of actual dialogue, dropping the eerie dream language entirely. While not a sequel or a prequel, Journey of Dreams is more commonly understood to be a story taking place in a different universe with no direct canonical connection to the first game. Like a parallel dimension, it will follow similar plot-based events but handle them differently. Reala's role during Journey of Dreams sees him confronting NiGHTS about her carefree life and scorning her for disobeying Wiseman's orders. Due to this, NiGHTS is constantly facing off against Reala's army of minions as he attempts to capture her and take her back to the Land of Nightmare. Although he tries many times to catch her, he ultimately fails, leading to one final confrontation towards the end of the game, which Reala loses. Again. And this time he didn't even blow up. Man just vanished. Yeah, straight up Houdini'd that shit. Like, I don't know what happened here, if Sonic Team had to cut a bunch of content due to being pressed by the upper heads at Sega, but after the boss fight, Reala is never seen again. Yeah, you go through the whole game continuously being ridiculed by Reala as he appears at every turn, and the whole beef escalates into a final face-off that does not have a conclusion between the two characters. Are you serious? Look, there's dropping the ball, and then there's dropping the ball into a black hole and making sure nobody ever sees that shit again.
Visual design.
When Wiseman created the Nightmare and creatures, he purposely wanted NiGHTS and Reala to stand out due to their place in the hierarchy. This is why many of the other bosses take the forms of animals or objects, while NiGHTS and Reala have a more human-based appearance. Even Jackal, a boss that comes close to a human form, lacks an actual visible body. But while Reala and NiGHTS are superior by design to each other, they are designed to be opposites. NiGHTS' sleek frame is counter to that of Reala's more muscle-toned build. NiGHTS' hat has a more rounder, smoother curve to the horns, while Reala's hat angles outwardly with sharper corners. Even the colours express their differences. NiGHTS' whimsical flamboyance is present in her purple tones, adding an air of mystery and intrigue to her appearance. Reala, on the other hand, houses a combination of solid blacks and deep reds, not only offering a more harder personality, but also displaying a level of unease within the arrangements of these colours. The striped horns in particular almost appear very wasp-like in design. Reala's base layer is white, but this is not to show any levels of purity or innocence in the character. Instead, the white is used as a blank canvas to paint on top of, allowing all the other colours to appear bolder and sharper as a result. It's further enforced by the fact that the main areas in which you see any uninterrupted white tones are the upper arm and upper leg areas. These sections are bridges to the next cluster of colours, with the white acting as the oxygen between them. White is also used on the face as part of his makeup, allowing the black lines on his eyes and mouth to appear sharper, giving Reala a much more sinister expression. This design is really damn cool. It does extra well when you pair it up alongside NiGHTS' design, so you can see how each of their individual aspects counter one another's. It's a solid look for an antagonist in a role like this, and due to his lack of any real storyline involvement in the first game, it was this visual design alone that made me like Reala as much as I did in those days. Then, Journey of Dreams happened, and... No. Whereas NiGHTS' design seemed to evolve into a more realised outfit, showing us a commitment to portraying the character in a circus ringleader vibe, Reala's redesign is a bit of a confused mess. You've got a pink neck ruffle to match the elegance of his persona mask, presenting the character as part of the same circus court atmosphere that NiGHTS is being presented in, but then you suddenly arc off down a more samurai-style route with the red and black body armour, before getting sidetracked again by incorporating a bloody tribal flame design into said armour, making the character look like a Hot Topic reject circa 2003. You've got these weird rips on his white areas that look so cartoonish that they appear more like bat symbols than they do anything else. And then to round it all off, you've taken the poor boy to get his flipping nails done because for some strange reason, they're pink. They could have been black to match the feathers, they could have been red to match his outfit, but no, they're pink. For whatever bloody reason. There are parts of his old design still located within his new look, but they've either been tweaked without reason or rudely obstructed by the extra fluff. The shape of his hat has now become more smoother curved, taking away some of that sharper edged qualities that I liked about his old design. The black stripes are now this weird diluted shade instead, making the hat lose some of the stronger solid tones on it. And his face. The makeup, one of the most crucial design aspects on the character, is covered up by his persona mask. In the game, the persona masks were items used by Reala and Knights to show their loyalty to Wiseman. Knights naturally takes hers off because she's gone all renegade, but Reala keeps his on to show how unbreakable his devotion is to his master. That's a very good story point to include, and I'm not mocking the meaning behind it, but you can't see his makeup at all anymore. The one feature that showed you upfront and personal how sinister Reala could appear on a first glance is now completely covered up. For me, growing up with the old design and then seeing how much of it gets brushed to the side in favour of chucking a mixed bag of clothes onto him feels like a step back in many aspects. Reala's original design is my preferred default look for this character, hands down. Personality. Reala is a cold and conniving character lacking any compassion. He lies and cheats his way to victory, and any truth he does tell is usually a twisted version of the real facts so that he can manipulate those around him. He is brash, cocky, and overall full of himself. There have only been two things so far that have caused Reala to behave otherwise. The first is Lord Wiseman. Naturally, Reala is incredibly loyal to him. He will obey every order, and should he fail, he will return to Wiseman with fear and humiliation. For all of Reala's menacing traits, he is not so arrogant to ever place himself above Lord Wiseman and recognizes his place in the pecking order. The other moment of weakness is when Cerberus the Hellhound is introduced. On the surface, Cerberus was just another boss like any other. However, the story did seem to want to play off of the fact that this creature had a high threat level to it. Wiseman uses Cerberus to not only intimidate knights, but Reala himself, and Reala does seem to harbour some genuine fear towards the beast. When taking these two things into account, it highlights the fact that Reala values his own life and understands that to displease his master would mean death. Therefore, it does beg the question then, is Reala's loyalty to Wiseman out of honour and respect, or is it built off of fear? Respect would mean there's admiration towards his master, yet anytime Reala is actually around Wiseman, he shows nothing but apprehension. I wouldn't go so far as to say Reala is carrying out his objectives due to fear alone, because when he is in the act of performing a hideous task, he is clearly enjoying himself. He obviously revels in the despair of others, but there's clearly a part of him that knows failure would mean punishment, and so it likely pushes him further to succeed. It might actually be due to his free will, seeing as he and Knights are the only two creatures in Wiseman's army to display advanced intelligence. Reala's free will and understanding of action-reaction has in turn made him an obedient servant, because he recognises the dangers of what would happen to him if he made any outlandish choices like Knights has done. Taking all of this into account, Reala's attitude may be fairly straightforward as far as an eccentric villain goes, but it works for him. Journey Dreams was the game to bring out Reala's personality, and it's safe to say he mostly contains the traits that I expected of him.
Importance.
Okay, here's where we run into trouble with Reala and what ultimately puts the character on the back burner for me. His importance to the universe and lore is obviously paramount, there's no two ways about that. Wiseman created Reala and Knights to be equals, and if they're equals then that means that for as long as Knights is out there shaking her bum bum in the nightclubs, it's always going to be Reala who's hunting her down and attempting to bring her home. It's his job to get in Knights' way more than any other character. He is her direct opposition. That's how valuable he is as a cast member. And all that sounds very positive so far, doesn't it? What was it about this that caused me to feel so negative in the end? Well, it's the direction and execution of it all. Reala is a character with so much wasted potential. In the first game, we got given a 5-second cutscene that injected a hint as to what Reala was like, and Journey of Dreams had every available opportunity to take this further. While they definitely built upon his personality and gave us the type of character we expected him to be, it just feels like they never travelled anywhere with it. The direction of the story made sure Reala was present in almost half of the game's cutscenes, and yet at no point did it ever feel like he was a genuine threat. And he should have been. This guy is meant to be the bloody nemesis. Instead, every cutscene that you see him in, Reala spends more time casually chatting breeze with the very people he's against. Other characters should feel fear around him. He's supposed to be the highest level Nightmarin. Everywhere he goes, he's meant to carry this pressuring weight of despair and dread, and he's just floating there. With his bird squad. While he puts knights in a cage. Again. Then there's the moments where you do actually have a fight with Reala and... my god, what the hell happened here? The Reala boss battle in Knights into Dreams had the right idea and attempted to be something epic, if a bit confusing for first time viewers. It consists of both characters attempting to paraloop each other in a display of high-flying acrobatics. Every time you struck Reala, he was thrown into parts of the stage, breaking through scenery and tearing down structures. The graphical limitations of the Sega Saturn meant we got the general idea of what this fight was like, but it wasn't going to capture the very essence of their rivalry on the scale in which it needed to be seen in. I always wanted to see the day where graphics were not going to restrict this, and we could finally see these two battle flat out, destroying everything around them as they swoop and spiral around each other. Instead, Journey of Dreams had us throw balls around. Dirty balls. Why are we throwing dirty balls around? Why did you bring these shitty dirty balls with you, Reala? There is absolutely nothing dramatic about this. These boss fights take the fact that they're equal beings with the same skill sets and throws it right through the windshield. Nothing here shows off what Reala can do when facing his direct opposite. It was a chance to really display something truly breathtaking between two evenly matched combatants, and in the end we got fucking dodgeball. But the final aspect that feels so wasted is the missed opportunity to fully elaborate on Reala's broken bond with NiGHTS. They were two sides of the same coin, and until the day when NiGHTS abandoned her position in the hierarchy, these two nightmarins stood side by side. To suddenly have one of these characters leave the other behind, that's going to create a really strained rift between them. Journey of Dreams skirted around this a little, it wouldn't be right of me to say it didn't touch upon this topic, but the game seemed more focused on treating the subject lightheartedly without ever really delving into the specifics. This should have been a bigger deal than it was made out to be. We're talking about NiGHTS, who was originally a villain, turning her back on her master's empire. She became a traitor. Any bond that Reala had with NiGHTS was gone. This broken bond could have given Reala a shot at being a more three-dimensional antagonist, one who serves his master but also has his own personal beef with NiGHTS for their destroyed friendship. Again, it was just another wasted opportunity. Reala is one of the most important characters in this series. I do not deny him of that status, and I never will, but I cannot pretend that I don't feel disappointment when I see what they had in their hands and what they chose to do with it in the end. NiGHTS needed a rival, an antagonist in the series that would oppose her. She got that. Reala is a character with the capabilities of providing something warranted and suitable, but I feel the most crucial of corners kept getting cut with him as time went on. I look at Reala's early years and see expectations of great things to come, but when those times arrived, some points hit their target while the more important pieces of Reala's puzzle ended up flying out of bounds. His personality was explored further, but it feels like they never took the character further. He has connections to the protagonist that could have presented us a great story of betrayal filled with bittersweet resentment, and it just wasn't there. Reala came off more like a monster of the week than a weighted adversary. I don't hate him. I feel for a while I was just mostly pissed off at all the things that could have been, and in turn that's why I took my step away from the character. Do I feel his fanbase is warranted now? Definitely. He has every right to a fanbase because there's clearly aspects about him that attract fans in the first place, and I can see the potential in him too. I just don't feel that potential has been realized yet. He needs the right sort of person behind him to write him through a really strong storyline, and then they will have Reala nailed. Pink fingernails or otherwise. Yo, this episode was brought to you by these wonderful people supporting me on Patreon. Without their help, this show would not be able to continue. If you'd also like to support Who Dat, please check the link in the description. Any and all help would be appreciated. Cheers, everybody.